Well, I remember one time. You know, there is a time when you are pushed to the brink, when you do not go any further. Now, it presents a difficult problem to the men around you when you are pushed to the brink, particularly when you are pushed to a universal brink. You know what I mean by a universal brink? A thing that everybody secretly agrees with. And so once you blow your stack, they really can't get mad at you because it's a thing that has bugged them. Now, I'll tell you, one of the beautiful things, I've noticed that a lot of people continue to write essays, stories, and so on about the war and about the army. Well, I think the reason this is so, one of the reasons, of course there are many reasons, but one of the reasons is that everything in life is crystal clear in the army. I mean, people get killed, everything is there. There is a drive for power, there is rank, there is isolation, there is naval contemplation, there is all kinds of stuff goes on in the army that hardly ever is actually perceived in civilian life. Now let me tell you one time, I'm in his outfit, see, and we were on a 20-mile, it was the last one of a series of like 400 of these things that we had made, a 20-mile forced tactical bivouac march. Now this was going on in the Ozarks, and it was, I cannot tell you how hot it was. It was unbelievably hot. Hot because each one of us had 67 pounds of field equipment on our back. It was complete infantry field equipment. The whole business. Entrenching tools, extra shoes, sea rations. We had all the works. The pup tent, the tent pegs. I could go right down and give you the whole business. The ropes. We had the blankets, the extra blankets, the extra fatigues. We had the tin hat on. We had the canteen full of old cruddy rotten water. We had the entrenching tool hanging on the side. We had the gas mask. We had the medical kit. We had the entrenchment knife. We had the bayonet. We had an M1. It's all there, you know, all hanging down, all pulling you down towards the ground. See, the gravity pulls it down. That's the way it goes. It just pulls you down, and you're standing between the earth and all that junk. And it's pushing down on you, and you're pushing up on it, and you're propelling yourself forward through the Ozarks. Well, now, let me tell you, the Ozarks, they have these, it isn't what exactly they sing about in the folk songs. And we have slogged like 44 miles, it seems like, already since the crack of dawn. And we have done this for 3 straight days. It's beginning to, you know, it's getting boring. I'll tell you, you have no idea. Do you know what it's like to go, say, 25 miles with absolutely nothing on your mind? You are going nowhere. You have come from nowhere. And all you know is you gotta go. You just gotta keep moving, moving, moving. You gotta go. And the dust is rising all around you, and the sweat is dribbling down from your tin hat and running into your eyes and running around your nose and making long streaks. And you're itching all over. Terrible places you itch in the Army. I can't even tell you where you itch in the Army. You itch in the Army for a lot of reasons, like you haven't had a shower for a week. I mean, that's the way it is out there in the field, you know? And you itch all for a lot of reasons. And you're itching all over, and you're hot. And so you get to the point where you're sort of numb. You see, you just go, clunk, 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 clunk. And you get a rhythm in your mind. It's a rhythm in your mind. Just, you move, clunk, 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 clunk. And stuff rattles. Just steady rattle, 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 rattle. And once in a while, a guy will holler, "Briscoes!" Well, without thinking, automatically, you rip open your gas mask, pull it over your sweat and all the crud and the mud, and you go, you're breathing through this nutty thing, and it's got these big plastic eye things, you know, and immediately they're all clouded over, and the sweat begins to gather around in the rubber. And the more you go, the more it scrapes your skin. You have not shaved, and when you did shave, like yesterday, you shaved with cold water. So now you've got nothing but raw pieces and chunks all over, and you shave with one of those idiotic army razor blades. Have you ever seen an army razor blade? It's made out of cardboard. Fascinating kind of razor blade. Really interesting. It's like a little hole, actually, the razor that they give you in the Army. It's a little black plastic razor, and it kind of works like, go, I'll tell you, it isn't the kind that Mickey Mantle used during the World Series, you know. So it just takes little pieces of skin. Then it misses everything for a long ways. Just means a little long thing. And you wind up with those little patches all over you, you know, like Fu Manchu had. And the patch is surrounded by small cuts. And the small cuts are surrounded by large cuts. And then the large cuts are surrounded by big grooves. And so it sweats in this, you see, and then it begins to get dirt in it. You're tattooed, like, with crud. And you walk... Then you hear, oh, clear! Oh, my God. Oh. And you go, you pull this thing off, and you're still going, you know, and you're pushing the gas mask down. And you wipe it out of your eyes, and it's dripping. And then he'll holler, 5 minute break, four! All out, all out! At ease! And I'm going, you sit down. And you unclip the top clip. There's a clip that goes across your chest with your pack. It just lets you breathe a little bit. You never take it off, ever. You unclip it, and you lean back on it, and you push the hat back. And you sit like that, and immediately your mind sort of goes blank. And just as you start slowing them, you hear the whistles. Right on up! And away you go. And it goes like this. You see, it goes like this endlessly. I cannot describe it to you. You little ladies that lived all of your lives in Queens wouldn't know this. It's like you're permanently out of your skull. Absolutely, absolutely, thoroughly, and completely hysterical. And you have lost grip, all complete, thorough, and utter on reality. Well, now, there are two ways you react to this. There's the kind of guy, I'm one of those, whose mind completely goes to sleep. It just goes out in left field and stays out there and plays catch, is what it does. It fools around, it kicks in the grass, and does nothing, you know, just sort of flubs around. And your body just... We have been doing this now for what seemed like a month. And every once in a while, a little cloud of dust in the Ozarks, in the fantastic heat, because there are hills and there are trees and forests and everything around, there are strange patches of inconsistent air, which causes puffs of smoke and dust to rise. Like, you get a blast full of this yellow dust in your face. It goes, and you're just going, and you're sweating. You're so sweat, the guy ahead of you is just a moving thing, and you kind of center on that. You know, Ed, it's a funny thing. You don't know that you're in a column. You don't know that you're marching. You just center on this guy who's ahead of you going up and down. So you just go up and down, all of you go up and down. And you watch the guy's pack up ahead of you. He's moving up and down. You see his hat going up and down. And once in a while, he moves a little bit to the left, and you sort of move to the left. That's all. That's the way a column of men marches. They don't have any conception of being in a gigantic column. It's just a guy sort of ahead of you, and a lot of dust of stuff going and rattles and things going up and down. And once in a while, some guy will say something like, oh, you know, something like that. Or somebody will make some rotten, ridiculous remark, oh, boy, gas is a fink. And then everybody will say, gas is a fink. Ha, 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 gas is a fink. And there will be a little momentary divertissement. Gas is a fink. Ha, 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 gas is a fink. Ha, ha, and gas will say, knock it off, will ya? This is the way it goes. Well, we have gone on like this for, I'd say, probably 6.5 hours, or maybe 7.5, maybe 9 hours. I don't know. Maybe it was half of the war. I don't know how long we had been doing this, because, I was partially unconscious. Well, we had a 10-minute break. Now, the 10-minute break, you understand what Einstein meant by relativity. Let me tell you this. On a forced march, a 10-minute break goes by in a quarter of a millisecond. You sit down and you get up. It's like you're halfway down and the guy's blowing a whistle. And you don't even know it. You don't even remember having it. So we squat down like that. And you take this canteen. You spit it out. It tastes like chlorine and crud. Because, see, we've taken all our water out of the creek. And you know, the creek, there was a lot of other stuff in the creek. There were cows in the creek. And you know what cows do. And you know, so we had to put it. Yeah, we put the chlorine. That's the fact. We were out on field. It was a real field. So everything is rotten. You know, the one. Bah! You go. Bah! And it's just wet. That's all. You get your teeth. Your teeth are itchy. And they've got little coats all over them, you know. And there's little bath mats on your tongue. Bah! You cough a little of the crud out. And then the first thing you do is try to blow the dirt out of your nose. You get dirt in your nose. You go. You're blown away there, and everybody's snorting and hollering, and a couple of guys try to light cigarettes. Well, all of a sudden, The whistle blows, we get up, and we start to go. Well, there was a funny moment. It was as though, you know, you get so used to a routine that the instant one little thing is gone, you know it. One little thing is gone. That's, you know, old people who are really hooked on routine are very disturbed when somebody moves one little vase out of place because their whole routine is disturbed, and that means danger. And once that routine is disturbed, you could very well die because of that danger. Well, so immediately, there's a funny feeling in the platoon. I was in Company K, you know, and immediately, the guys in the 3rd platoon, I'm in the 3rd platoon, immediately there's a funny feeling. You see guys sort of looking around like that, and then you hear the whistle blow. The whistle stops us. Our company stops. And there are guys running back and forth, and you know, there's sort of a little shifting in the ranks, and I look around, and I see Clevenger. Clevenger is a guy from the next barracks, in my same outfit, in my platoon. Clevenger is sitting under the tree that we have just left. And Clevenger is leaning back against the tree and will not get up. Clevenger is just sitting there, and he's not knocked out. He is not out of his skull. He is sitting. Well, the Lieutenant Cherry runs back, and he's hollering, "Come on, Clevenger, get up, will you? Come on now, come on, Clevenger." Well, Clevenger, see, all of us were about 18 and 19, something like that, 17, 18, 19-year-old kids. And Clevenger is sitting there, a great big round moon face from Lake Forest, Illinois. I remember Clevenger came from Lake Forest Academy. I was always impressed because he went to the same school Big Spiderbeck went to. And it was a very chic school. Well, Clevenger is sitting right down there, flat out, with his pack on, and he's sitting under the tree. He won't get up. So Cherry says to him, "Now get up, Clevenger. Will you get up?" Well, Cherry, you see, Lieutenant Cherry is a lieutenant from Illinois, from the University of Illinois. He is roughly 21. He is an ROTC lieutenant, and he has been about to cry all day long, you see, because he is really bugged too. And you can see there's a note of hysteria about Lieutenant Cherry. And he says, "Come on, Clevenger, will you get up?" And you can see all the companies behind us are piling up. Remember, there is about 14,000 guys. It's the whole Second Army that's marching around out there. So it isn't just our little group, you know. And you can see a great crowd, and they have all stopped, and the whole shebang. And Cherry says, "Come on, Clevenger, will you get up?" Well, we had this red-headed corporal who was a Tennessee corporal and was a National Guard corporal, and he had delusions of grandeur. So he comes running back. He says, "Will you get up there? Will you move your Clevenger? Now, you go ahead." Well, that has been censored. He says, "Will you move that, Clevenger, or I'm going to kick you black and blue right here?" Well, Clevenger says, "Go ahead." He says, "I'm not going to go." Well, Clevenger, you know, is standing there, sitting and sort of leaning back, just looking, and all of us are looking around. And Cherry, of course, now we're getting a little bugged at Clevenger because now the whole army is behind us, and the bunch of guys ahead of us is kind of receding in the distance, and a couple of jeeps are coming back from where the general is. And Cherry is saying, "Now, come on, will you, Clevenger, get up?" He says, "Look, now listen. I'm not going to fool around, Clevenger. You are in trouble. You hear that?" Nothing. Obviously, Clevenger is not impressed. And the corporal Red is getting red. He is purple in the face. He's running back and forth. And Cherry says, "Look, now look, Clevenger. Now get up, walk a little ways, and we'll take you in the jeep. Call the jeep, Red. Call the jeep, corporal." Well, the corporal runs off. And with that, Clevenger gets up, and Clevenger's pack starts to fall apart. Clevenger gets up, and his blanket falls down. He has unhooked the rope. For some reason or other, he wanted to make it all loose on him, and it's fallen out. And the lieutenant blows the whistle, and we start to go, and his shoe falls out. Well, Clevenger is walking along beside the outfit, and his shoe falls out, and poor Lieutenant Cherry picks up the shoe. He doesn't know what to do. Lieutenant Cherry is carrying Clevenger's shoe. Well, then he goes a little further. We're walking along. We're all going along. And, of course, now it's a little excitement. Everybody's looking out of the corner of his eye, and the dust is raising. And Clevenger is trailing a rope, and his tent pegs are falling out. And he's just sort of clumping around. He's not in step or anything. He's just walking along. He is so bugged, he doesn't care what happens, and his tent pegs are falling out. And Lieutenant Cherry has got his tent pegs now. And with that, three cans of sea rations come plopping out. And Cherry's got the sea rations. And Cherry is walking along, and he's got a pack on his back, you know. He's got a pack on his back, and his hat's going up and down, and his new uniform is all dirty, and all of us like that. And he says, "Now, hold it. Now, look here, will you? Hold here. Take your shoes, Clevenger." And Clevenger's just walking. Clevenger's not doing anything. Well, within 5 minutes, Lieutenant Cherry not only has the tent pegs, he's got his shovel, which has fallen down. He has now got his blanket, which is trailing on the ground, and he is carrying all of this guy's stuff in his arms, a great big basket of junk. And I don't know whether you've ever seen a field pack, infantry, M1, reduced to its basic components. It is worse than coming home from Bohacks on Saturday night with 2 weeks' worth. Well, he's got this stuff in his hands, and we're all going along, and it's just a terrible moment. But the worst of it all was that nobody could quite get mad at Clevenger. Because he was doing what all of us felt like doing, just letting it all go, you know? Let it all flop off. Just go on, throw it all away. And poor old Cherry, he's walking along, and I thought any minute he's going to cry. And suddenly, we see from the distance, down comes the Jeep. It comes tearing down there, and Red is sitting in the Jeep next to the company courier, and they're sitting in the Jeep. Oh, they come. Oh, the Jeep spins around, and the lieutenant blows the whistle and says, "Fall out." Well, all of us fall out. And he piles Clevenger in the Jeep. He throws all of Clevenger's stuff in the Jeep behind him. He says to the corporal, he says, "Corporal, take him up front." And the Jeep roars away. And you can see Red all hollering at poor Clevenger. And Clevenger never said anything all through the whole business. He is just sitting there, and all you see is the back of his helmet disappearing into the distance. Well, we rest about 2 minutes, and a couple of companies go past us. And finally, Lieutenant Cherry gets up, and he says, All right, you men, I hope all of you saw that Clevenger has made a spectacle of himself. I hope all of you know that the entire outfit, the 803rd Signal Training Battalion, is laughing at Company K. I hope you know that. And I hope you know that it reflects on all of us. Now, I want you guys to fall in. I want you guys to fall in, and I want you guys to march. Now, let's go. Let's get moving, you guys. All right, now. Here we go. Up, two, three, four. Up, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. All right, now, I want all of you guys to sing. Now, let's all sing. We'll sing Matilda. Are you ready to go? We'll sing Matilda. We'll sing Matilda. Up, two, three, four. Up, two, three, four. All right, come on. Pull in your brakes. Let's go. Pull in your cup, gasser. Come on now. Let's get us straightened up, all you guys. Come on, here we go. Up, two, three, four. Up, two, three, four. All together now, gang. All right. All you guys in here, pull in your guts and bellow it out.
I never cared for eyes of blue.
She's got eyes of blue.
That's my weakness now.
She's got dimpled cheeks. And that's my weakness now. All right. Oh, me, oh, my. Now, kid, what I'm trying to tell you here is that you ain't ever going to get over being bugged. You know, speaking, if you want to talk more about getting bugged, I'll tell you one time I saw a guy do something. You see, all of us live in the world where we are held down, controlled, and molded by the thing we call civilization. You know that, Ed. You know what would happen then. You know, if you were given your choice, you know what you'd do. You know what you do. There's a lot of times, and you do too, Dad. I can see you back there leaning on your broom. You know what you'd do if you had your choice, absolute choice of what to do. Listen, you'd go out of your skull about four times a day, just like I would, you know, if I could get away with it. And it is always an awe-inspiring sight when you see somebody who has really popped his cork. Now, I don't mean gone out of a skull. I mean somebody who's really said, okay, I have had enough of this jazz. Absolutely enough. And it is a frightening and yet at the same time a kind of inspiring sight. You see, again, I must refer to the Army. Now, another one of the things about the Army that perhaps has never been brought home very clearly to you is that the Army does everything at very terrible hours. They have no conception of comfort in the Army. And furthermore, there is a relentlessness about it. You know that civilian life does not have that raw relentlessness. You always suspect somehow you can push a little bit. You know, you can be late 20 minutes to work if you want to fool around a little bit, if you want to stop by Needix, you know, and slug down some orange drink or something, fool around, go to a chock full of nuts, you know, and goof off a couple hours in the afternoon. Well, let me tell you this. In the Army, there is a constant repetition of a theme of almost insensate masochism. Now, nobody in his right mind, you know, a lot of guys go to bed at 10 minutes after 5, but nobody gets up at 10 minutes after 5. Unless there's something really troubling them, you know, there's real problems. Well, the average guy is not aware, you see, of the relentless passage of time in his life. In the Army, it is brought home to you so that it's like the Chinese water torture. A little drop of time, every second and a half, drops right in the middle of your forehead. And you know it is there. That, I think, is one of the scariest things about the Army. Time escapes you so fantastically rapidly, and yet at the same time it goes so immeasurably slowly that you are so conscious of time you can't escape it. You see, most times in the civilian life, you can goof off a lot. You know, you do a lot of things that make you forget that it's Wednesday. Well, in the Army, it seems like every so often a bugle goes off, or a cannon goes off, or a guy blows a whistle, or you are moved forward or backward, and almost invariably on a time basis. Well, there are certain people who can get used to it. You can get immune to that, you know. Other people don't get immune to it. And yet nobody really, truly gets completely calloused over. It is always there. Well, I remember one time, we're in the Army, and we are in a bunch of tents. It does not make any difference where this was. But let us put it this way. We were in tents that were old and were battered and were torn. And it was bitter cold. Bitter, bitter cold. Now, you see, in civilian life, you can always escape the elements pretty much. In the summertime, you go where it's air-conditioned, or you go to the beach. Somehow, you can move around a little bit to escape that fantastic sun that beats down. And in the wintertime, likewise, you're in something. But in the Army, when you're in a rotten old tent, and the wind is blowing through it, and you've got a little pot stove, and nobody has brought fuel up for the past 6 days or so, it is cold. And I mean cold right to the very bone. Just all the way through, so cold that you don't really any longer feel cold. You just feel a kind of, I guess you get a kind of lassitude about you. A kind of apathy sets in. A kind of, you just move as though you're moving in a dream. Well, the one great thing about being in the Army in terrible cold is burrowing into your sack. You cover yourself up. I remember we were sleeping. We had our raincoats out. Can you imagine? It was so cold that we had on top of the sacks, on the little bunks that we had, we even put our gas masks out to lay them on top of us, our tent pegs on top of us to keep warm. You know, we're all huddled. I'm telling you the truth. We're all huddled under there, you see. And we each had one blanket apiece. And it is bitter cold. We're sleeping in our raincoats, our overcoats, our fatigues, our chinos. We got everything we possibly got on. 4 pairs of shoes. I had shoes over my ears and everything. We're laying there, see? Well, it seems like the instant you get into the sack, they're blowing a whistle. And it's black, dark pitchness. And you're getting out. Well, we continued like this for 4 years, something like that. You know, just keep doing this. It's insensible. It's insane. Well, you don't even think anymore. The whistle blows, you get up. Just get up. You don't even think of griping or anything. You just get up. You know, isn't it interesting how in the movie version of the Army, they always have guys griping? No, real soldiers don't. You never gripe about getting up or anything. It is so much ingrained in you, it's like griping about breathing. Do you ever gripe about breathing? Do you ever gripe because the light is red and it changes green? No, you just accept it, you know. Do you gripe about cars riding up and down 6th Avenue? Or horns blowing on? No, you don't. You never gripe. You really don't. That's one of the great misconceptions people have about you. You don't gripe. And so you just get up dumbly, you know, and the guys, you know, they talk a little, hi, gas, and the guy's putting the shoes in. You got to stand out there in the darkness and they're calling the roll. And you just automatically, here. Well, suddenly there was a pause and some guy didn't answer. Well, one of the corporals goes back into the tent with a flashlight to look. And he comes out and he says, hey, Sergeant. And the sergeant, what do you want? He says, Sergeant Watkins won't get up. He says he's going to stay in bed. He said, what? Watkins won't get up. He's in bed. He said, what? He says, Watkins won't get up, I said. The sergeant said, what are you talking about? And he goes tearing around the platoon and goes in. And I hear a lot of yelling. Watkins is in his sack and won't get up. Just won't get up. Well, the corporal and the sergeant yell, and suddenly both of them pick up his sack and carry it right out and carry it away. We never saw him again. And there wasn't one of us, but one of us, who didn't know that we had learned a lesson, a very serious lesson that night.